Well, I was afraid that you were engaged.
So I am. Very much so.
Well, then I can wait in the next room.
Not at all. Mr. Jabez Wilson here has been good enough to call upon me this morning and to begin a narrative which promises to be one of the most singular which I have listened to for some time. In the present instance, I am forced to admit that the facts are, to the best of my belief, unique. And now, Mr. Wilson, off you go at scratch and tell us all about yourself, your household, and the effect which this advertisement had upon your fortunes.
Well, it is just as I've been telling you, Mr. Sherlock Holmes. I have a small pawnbroker's business at Coburg Square, near the city. It's not a very large affair, and of late years it's not done more than just give me a living. I used to be able to keep two assistants, but now I only keep one. And I would have a job to pay him, but that he's willing to come for half wages so as to learn the business.
What is the name of this obliging youth?
His name is Vincent Spaulding, and he's not such a youth either. I should not wish a smarter assistant, Mr. Holmes, and I know very well that he could better himself, and even twice what I'm able to give him. It is not a common experience among employers in this age.
Oh, he has his faults, too.
Never was such a fellow for photography. Snapping him over the camera when he ought to be improving his mind, and then diving down into the cellar like a rabbit into its hole to develop his pictures. That is his main fault. But on the whole, he's a good worker. There's no vice in him.
He is still with you, I presume?
Oh, yes, sir.
He came down into the office just this day 8 weeks with this very paper in his hand, and he says, "I wish to the Lord, Mr. Wilson, that I was a red-headed man."
"Why that?" I asks.
"Why," says he, "he is another vacancy on the League of the Red-Headed Men."
"What is it, then?" I asked.
"Have you never heard of the League of the Red-Headed Men?" he asked with his eyes open.
"Never. Tell me all about it," said I.
"Well," said he, showing me the advertisement, "you can see for yourself that the League has a vacancy, and there is the address where you should apply for particulars."
As far as I can make out, the League was founded by an American millionaire, Ezekiel Hopkins, who was very peculiar in his ways. He himself was red-headed, and he had a great sympathy for all red-headed men. So, when he died, it was found that he had left his enormous fortune in the hands of trustees, with instructions to apply the interest to the providing of easy births to men whose hair is of that colour. From all I hear, it is splendid pay and very little to do. Vincent Spaulding seemed to know so much about it that I thought he might prove useful. So I just ordered him to put up the shutters for the day and to come right away with me. He was very willing to have a holiday. So we shut up the business and started off for the address that was given in the advertisement. I never hope to see such a sight as that again, Mr. Holmes. From north, south, east and west, every man who had a shade of red in his hair had tramped into the city to answer the advertisement. Fleet Street was choked with red-headed folk, and Pope's Court looked like a Costa's orange barrow. I should not have thought that there were so many in the whole country was brought together by that single advertisement. When I saw how many were waiting, I would have given it up in despair. But Spaulding would not hear of it. How he did it, I could not imagine, but he pushed and pulled and butted until he got me through the crowd and soon found ourselves in the office. There was nothing in the office but a couple of wooden chairs and a deal table, behind which sat a small man with a head that was even redder than mine. However, when our turn came, the little man was more favourable to me than to any of the others, and he closed the door as we entered, so that he might have a private word with us. He took a step backwards, cocked his head on one side, and gazed at my hair, until I felt quite bashful. Then, suddenly, he plunged forward, wrung my hand, and congratulated me warmly on my success. He stepped over to the window and shouted through it at the top of his voice that the vacancy was filled. "My name," said he, "is Mr. Duncan Ross,
and I am myself one of the pensioners upon the fund left by our noble benefactor. Well, you have to be in the office, or at least in the building, the whole time. If you leave, you forfeit your position forever. The will is very clear upon that point. You don't comply with the conditions if you budge from the office during that time. No excuse will avail, said Mr. Duncan Ross, neither sickness nor business nor anything else. There you must stay, or you lose your billet. And the work is to copy out the Encyclopedia Britannica. There is the first volume of it in that press. You must find your own ink, pens and blotting paper, but we provide this table and chair. Will you be ready tomorrow? Certainly, I answered. Then goodbye, Mr. Jabez Wilson, and let me congratulate you once more on the important position which you have been fortunate enough to gain. Well, I thought over the matter all day, and by evening I was in low spirits again. But I quite persuaded myself that the whole affair must be some great hoax or fraud, though what its object might be I could not imagine. Well, to my surprise and delight, everything was as right as possible. The table was set out ready for me, and Mr. Duncan Ross was there to see that I got fairly to work. He started me off upon the letter A, and then he left me. But he would drop in from time to time to see that all was right with me. At 2 o'clock he bade me good day, complimented me upon the amount that I had written, and locked the door of the office after me. This went on day after day, Mr. Holmes, and on Saturday the manager came in and planked down 4 golden sovereigns for me week's work. It was the same the next week, and the same the week after. Every morning I was there at 10, and every afternoon I left at 2. By degrees, Mr. Duncan Ross took to come me in only once of a morning, and then, after a time, he did not come in at all. Still, of course, I never dared to leave the room for an instant, for I was not sure when he might come. And the billet was such a good one, and suited me so well, that I would not risk the loss of it. 8 weeks passed away like this, and I had written about abbots and archery and armour and architecture and Attica, and hoped with diligence that I might get on to the bees before very long. And then, suddenly, the whole business came to an end. To an end? Yes, sir. And no later than this morning. I went to my work, as usual, at 10 o'clock, but the door was shut and locked, with a little square of cardboard hammered onto the middle of the panel with a tack. The red-headed league is dissolved. Well, I was staggered, sir. I didn't know what to do. Then I called at the offices round, but none of them seemed to know anything about it. Finally, I went to the landlord, who is an accountant living on the ground floor, and I asked him if he could tell me what had become of the red-headed league. He said that he'd never heard of any such body. Then I asked him who Mr. Duncan Ross was. He answered that the name was new to him. I did not want to lose such a place without a struggle, so, as I had heard that you were good enough to give advice to poor folk who were in need of it, I came right away to you. And you did very wisely. Your case is an exceedingly remarkable one, and I shall be happy to look into it. And first one or two questions, Mr. Wilson. This assistant of yours, who first called your attention to the advertisement, how long had he been with you?
About a month, then.
How did he come?
In answer to an advertisement.
Was he the only applicant?
No, I had a dozen.
Why did you pick him?
Because he was handy and would come cheap.
At half wages, in fact.
Yes.
What is he like, this Vincent Spaulding? Small, stout built, very quick in his ways. No hair on his face, though he's not short of 30. Has a white splash of acid upon his forehead. He is still with you?
Oh, yes, sir. I've only just left him.
And has your business been attended to in your absence?
Nothing to complain of, sir. There's never very much to do of a morning.
That will do, Mr. Wilson. I shall be happy to give you an opinion upon the subject in the course of a day or two. Today is Saturday, and I hope that by Monday we may come to a conclusion. Well, Watson, what do you make of it all?
Well, I make nothing of it. It is a most mysterious business.
As a rule, the more bizarre a thing is, the less mysterious it proves to be.
What are you going to do, then?
To smoke. It is quite a three-pipe problem. And I beg that you won't speak to me for 50 minutes. What do you think, Watson? Could your patients spare you for a few hours?
Well, I have nothing to do today. My practice is never very absorbing.
Then, put on your hat and come. Thank you. I only wish to ask you how you would go from here to the Strand. Third right, fourth left.
Evidently, Mr. Wilson's assistant counts for a good deal in this mystery of the Red-Headed League. I'm sure that you inquired your way merely in order that you might see him.
Not him. What then? The knees of his trousers.
And what did you see?
My dear Doctor, this is a time for observation, not for talk. We are spies in an enemy's country. We know something of Saxe-Coburg Square. Let us now explore the paths which lie behind it. Let me see. I should just like to remember the order of the houses here. It is a hobby of mine to have an exact knowledge of London. There is Mortimer's, the tobacconist. The little newspaper shop, the Coburg branch of the City and Suburban Bank, the vegetarian restaurant, and McFarlane's carriage building depot. That carries us right onto the other block. You want to go home, no doubt, Doctor.
Yes, it would be as well.
And I have some business to do which will take some hours. This business at Coburg Square is serious.
Why serious?
A considerable crime is in contemplation. I have every reason to believe that we shall be in time to stop it. But today being Saturday rather complicates matters. I shall want your help tonight.
At what time?
10 will be early enough.
I shall be at Baker Street at 10.
Very well. And I say, Doctor, there may be some little danger. So kindly put your army revolver in your pocket. Ah, our party is complete. Watson, I think you know Mr. Jones of Scotland Yard. Let me introduce you to Mr. Merriweather, who is to be our companion in tonight's adventure. It is past 10, however, and quite time that we started. If you two will take the first hansom, Watson and I will follow in the second. You're not very vulnerable from above, nor from below. I must really ask you to be a little more quiet. We are at present, Doctor, as no doubt you have divined, in the cellar of the city branch of one of the principal London banks. Mr. Merriweather is the chairman of directors, and he will explain to you that there are reasons why the most daring criminals of London should take a considerable interest in this cellar at present.
It is our French gold. We have had several warnings that an attempt might be made upon it.
Your French gold?
Yes. We had occasion some months ago to strengthen our resources and borrowed for that purpose 30,000 Napoleons from the Bank of France. It has become known that we have never had occasion to unpack the money and that it is still lying in our cellar. Our reserve of bullion is much larger at present than is usually kept in a single branch office, and the directors have had misgivings upon the subject.
which were very well justified. And now it is time that we arranged our little plans. I expect that within an hour, matters will come to a head. In the meantime, Mr. Merryweather, we must put the screen over that dark lantern.
And sit in the dark?
I am afraid so. If they fire, Watson, have no compunction about shooting them down.
And now we must be silent and wait.
It's all clear. Have you the chisel and the bags? Great Scott! Jump, Archie, jump! And I'll swing for it!
It's no use, John Clay. You have no chance at all.
So I see.
I fancy that my pal is all right. There are three men waiting for him at the door.
Oh, indeed. You seem to have done the thing very completely. I must compliment you.
And I you. Your red-headed idea was very new and effective. Let me introduce you to John Clay, the murderer, thief, smasher and forger. He's a young man, Mr. Merryweather, but he is at the height of his profession. I would rather have my bracelets on him than on any criminal in London.
Really, Mr. Holmes, I do not know how the bank can thank you or repay you. There is no doubt that you have detected and defeated in the most complete manner one of the most determined attempts at bank robbery that have ever come within my experience.
I have had one or two little scores of my own to settle with Mr. John Clay. I have been at some small expense over this matter, which I shall expect the bank to refund. But beyond that, I am amply repaid by having had an experience which is in many ways unique. You see, Watson, it was perfectly obvious from the first that the only possible object of this rather fantastic business of the advertisement of the League and the copying of the encyclopedia must be to get this not over-bright pawnbroker out of the way for a number of hours every day. It was a curious way of managing it, but really it would be difficult to suggest a better. The method was no doubt suggested to Clay's ingenious mind by the colour of his accomplice's hair. They put in the advertisement. One rogue has the temporary office, the other rogue incites the man to apply for it. And together, they manage to secure his absence every morning in the week. From the time that I heard of the assistant having come for half wages, it was obvious to me that he had some strong motive for securing the situation.
Yeah, but how could you guess what the motive was?
The man's business was a small one, and there was nothing in the house which could account for such elaborate preparations and such an expenditure as they were at. It must then be something out of the house. What could it be? I thought of the assistant's fondness for photography and his trick of vanishing into the cellar. The cellar. There was the end of this tangled clue. Then I made inquiries as to this mysterious assistant and found that I had to deal with one of the coolest and most daring criminals in London. He was doing something in the cellar, something which took many hours a day for months on end. What could it be once more? I could think of nothing, save that he was running a tunnel to some other building. So far I had got when we went to visit the scene of action. I rang the bell, and, as I hoped, the assistant answered it. We have had some skirmishes, but we have never set eyes on each other before. I hardly looked at his face. His knees were what I wished to see. You must yourself have remarked how worn, wrinkled, and stained they were. They spoke of those hours of burrowing. The only remaining point was what they were burrowing for. I walked round the corner, saw the City and Suburban Bank abutted on our friend's premises, and felt that I had solved my problem.
And how could you tell that they would make their attempt tonight?
Well, when they closed their league offices, that was a sign that they cared no longer about Mr. Jabez Wilson's presence. In other words, that they had completed their tunnel. But it was essential that they should use it soon, as it might be discovered, or the bullion might be removed. Saturday would suit them better than any other day, as it would give them 2 days for their escape. For all these reasons, I expected them to come tonight.
Ah, you reasoned it out beautifully. It is so long a chain, and yet every link rings true.
It saved me from ennui. Alas, I already feel it closing in upon me. My life is spent in one long effort to escape from the commonplaces of existence. These little problems help me to do so.
And you are a benefactor of the race.
Well, perhaps after all it is of some little use. L'homme sait rien, l'œuvre sait tout. As Gustave Flaubert wrote to George Sand.